A warm welcome, dear children. We will start with the new lesson, that is structural organization in animals. All right, so we start with structural organization in animals. That is the lesson number 7 as per your CBSC NCERT book, right? Chapter 7. Okay, now since the portion, a lot of the portion in this lesson is deleted, so the part that we will study in this session, in this particular year, is only the animal tissues, right? So this is your syllabus for this lesson in this year. We will be doing only the animal tissues this year, right? So starting with the lesson, we move on to the animal tissues, and it says here that the tissue, we've just studied already what are the tissues, right? So what are the tissues? They are a group of cells having similar embryonic origin. That means their origin is similar, right? The embryonic origin is similar. They perform similar functions. And then it says here that the structure of the cell of a tissue may or may not be the same, right? So what are the characteristics we see? That their origin is same, right? Then their function is also similar. The only thing is that the cells of the tissue may or may not be the same structurally, right? So the cells of the tissue may or may not be the same. Be the same structurally. Now, what does this mean? Structurally. That means the cells that make up a tissue may be similar, or the shape may be similar, or they may be dissimilar as well, right? But whatever it is, the origin as well as the function remains the same, right? Then we further see that the term tissue was coined by Bichat. The study of tissue is known as histology, right? So the study of tissue is histology. And further we see that the term histology was coined by Meyer, right? Meyer is the scientist who coined the term histology, and Marcello Malfigi is called the father of histology, right? So Marcello Malfigi, he is the father of histology. What is histology? Histology is the study of tissue, right? So what is histology? Histology is the study of tissues, right? So that is histology. The term tissue was coined, I'm repeating, the term tissue was coined by Bichat, right? The study of tissue is known as histology. The term histology was coined by Meyer, and Marcello Malfigi is known as the father of histology. Now, since we are talking about the animal tissues, we see here that the animal tissues are classified into 4 types. So there are 4 types of animal tissues: the epithelial tissue, the connective tissue, the muscular tissue, and the nervous tissue, right? So today we will just be doing the epithelial tissues, right? So coming to the epithelial tissue, the term epithelial was coined by Roche, right? Because the cells have a tendency to grow over each other. It is the first tissue to evolve in the animal kingdom. Right now, this tissue is, you know, it is found all over in the body, and it is a kind of a protective tissue, right? So the term was coined by Roche, right? Because the cells have a tendency to grow over each other, right? So it can grow one on top over the each other, means one on top of the other also. So it is the first tissue that was evolved in the animal kingdom, and it may be derived. We talked about the three germ layers, right? Earlier we talked about the three germ layers. We talked about the ectoderm, the endoderm, and the mesoderm, right? So it is found to be, you know, connected to or derived from the ectoderm also. That is the ectoderm. The epidermis is derived from the ectoderm. Then from the endoderm, the mucosa of the alimentary canal is derived from the endoderm, and coelomic epithelium is derived from the mesoderm. So what do we get to see is that the epithelial tissue is found to be derived from all the three germ layers that you have studied, right? Coming to the features of epithelial tissue. So when we talk about the features, what do we mean by the features? The features are just the characteristics of the epithelial tissues, right? So what are the characteristics of the epithelial tissues? We find that the cells are arranged on a basal membrane. That means there is a kind of a basal membrane present, and on top of this basal membrane, the epithelial tissue is found to be arranged, right? This basal membrane is also known as the basal lamina, right? So that is the basal membrane or the basal lamina, the basal membrane. So the first characteristic we know about the epithelial tissue is that the cells of the epithelial tissue are arranged on a basement membrane, right? Now this membrane is made up of mucopolysaccharides and collagen fibers, and these substances are secreted by the cells themselves, so that the secretion forms the basal membrane. Then the second characteristic that we see is that the cells retain the power of division and regeneration throughout life. That means these cells can divide, or we can say they can regenerate throughout life. Every cell has its own lifespan. So till the time this cell is alive, it has the ability or the capability to divide, right? The third characteristic which we see is that the apical surface of the cell. Now what is the apical surface? If I draw a cell, then this is the apical surface and this is the posterior surface. The apical surface of the cell may bear cilia, small hair-like structures, right? They may bear a flagella, which is longer than the cilia. They may bear microvilli. Again, microscopic hair-like structures, microvilli, or they may bear stereocilia. Now, what is the stereocilia? They are also, apical modifications, but these are non-motile, right? So, microvilli, these are motile, but stereocilia is non-motile, or kinocilia. Now, what is this kinocilia? Cilia, when the word cilia is there, it means the hair-like projections are there. And this kinocilia is the apex of the hair cells, which are located in the sensory epithelium of the inner ear of a vertebrate, right? So, let's see here. This kinocilia, it is found in the inner ear of a vertebrate, right? So all the vertebrates have this, and this is the apex of the hair cells located in the sensory epithelium. These are coenocilia, hair-like structures, right? So that's about the epithelial tissues. The third character, we move further and we see that intercellular communications. Now what does this mean? Intercellular, inside the cell, the communication is possible due to desmosomes, right? Now if you see here, they are possible due to the presence of desmosomes, tight junctions, gap junctions, right? Then there are adherence junctions, right? So these are the structures which actually help in the communication in between the cells. Communication means transfer of certain substances in between the cells, and just now we will talk about what these tight junctions etc. are. We'll go into that detail, right? Then we come to the fifth characteristic, which says the epithelial tissues lack blood supply. Lack blood supply means there is no blood supply in the epithelial tissues, in epithelia, right? So when there is no blood supply in the epithelial tissues, we also call these tissues avascular. Absence of the vascular tissues, avascular, right? Then it says here, in the epithelial tissues, the plasma membrane of adjacent cells. Now what is the plasma membrane? When we talk about the animal cell, the plasma membrane is the outermost membrane of the animal cell, right? That is the plasma membrane or the plasma lemma, right? Now this is connected to the adjacent cell. It says here, in epithelial tissues, the plasma membrane of adjacent cells are interconnected. That means if there is another cell here, then how are these two cells connected? There is some connection that is made in between these two cells, right? The plasma membrane of these two cells. So they are joined through four different kinds of junctions. That means it is not that every cell will have the four different kinds of junctions. Depending from cell to cell, there are different types of junctions that join different types of cells, right? So we start with the first one, which is called the tight junction. Now the membranes of the adjacent epithelial tissues fuse together in a narrow band just beneath the apical surface with the help of some specific proteins. So actually all these junctions are made up of some specific proteins. Now these tight junctions are they are, in a way we can say, they act as barriers. Here you can see, here this is the tight junction. These tight junctions, they actually act as barriers in the cell, right? So they limit the passage of molecules. That means they do not allow a very free flow of molecules. They limit the passage of molecules and ions through the space between the cells. Now since they are tightly packed, if you look at these, they are tightly packed, and when they are tightly packed, so the space is less. When they are tightly packed, the space is less, and when the space is less, obviously the movement of the molecule becomes limited. So here the movement of the molecule becomes limited because of the limited space between the cells. So most materials must actually enter the cell. So then how will the connection be made? How will the contents be transferred from one cell to another? That is by the method of diffusion or active transport. The materials will have to enter the other cell, right? So from that cell, then it will be transferred. Then comes adherence junction. These tight junctions are only found in the vertebrates, right? Now adherence junction Now these adherence junctions are also known as belt desmosomes. Now the junctions help in anchoring the adjacent cells, anchoring, fixing the adjacent cells with each other through a complex of several proteins, including actin proteins. Right? Now, what is this? Actin filaments. What are these actin filaments? These actin filaments are actually proteins. Right? A kind of proteins that are present in the cytoplasm of the eukaryotic cells. So these are the kind of proteins that are present in the cytoplasm of eukaryotic cells. Then it says here, their one end is fixed in the cytoplasm and the other end traverses through the intercellular space. So one end is there in the cytoplasm and the other end, it moves in the intercellular space to join the counterpart from the adjacent cell. So that is how the connection between the adjacent cell to the cytoplasm, like that it is made. The next one is the gap junction. These are intercellular cylindrical channels, right? If you look at the diagram here, gap junctions, intercellular, they are cylindrical channels. The shape is cylindrical, about 1.5 to 2 nanometer in diameter. Now these permit the free passage of ions and small molecules. So gap junctions allow free movement of molecules right between the cells. Because ions can flow through them, the gap junction permits change in the membrane potential also. Obviously when it can flow, the potential of the membrane changes. Then the last one are the desmosomes. These are localized patches. Localized patches means they are found in a particular region, right? So they are localized patches that hold two cells tightly, right? So if you look at these desmosomes here, localized in a particular area, they are passages, they are patches that hold two cells tightly together. You can see here the holding. Desmosomes are the intermediate, they are attached to the intermediate filaments of keratin in the cytoplasm, right? So what are keratin? Keratin is also a protein, right? So they are attached to the filaments of keratin in the cytoplasm. So that's about how the connection or the communication between the tissue or the cell is maintained. All right, now we move on to the classification of epithelium, right? So these epithelial tissues are further classified into covering epithelium, glandular epithelium, and germinal epithelium. So we start with the first one. So we can say, in other words, we can say that the epithelium is classified into covering epithelium, right, number one, number two, into glandular epithelium, and number three, into germinal epithelium. So three types, and we start with the first one, that is the covering epithelium. Covering, to cover the outermost part, right? So it forms the outer and inner covering of various organs, right? Outer covering, as well, there are many organs that are there, and the inner covering of various organs are also the covering epithelium. Now depending upon the number of layers of cell, right? What do you understand by number of layers? Is it a single layer of cell? Is it a double layer of cell, right? Or are there more layers of cells, right? So now depending upon the layers of cells, they are further classified. So the first one is the simple epithelium, right? Now simple epithelium, you must remember that in every simple, when we use the word simple epithelium, it is made up of a single layer of cell, only one layer of cells, not one on top of the other, one single layer, right? Now this is, and this is clear that simple epithelium is just a single layer. And now on the basis of the height of the cells, right, height of the cells, are they tall, are they small, or are they flat, right? Now depending upon the size or height of the cell, it is further classified into squamous epithelium, columnar and cuboidal epithelium, right? Now all the others will be made up of these types of cells only. So let's see what are the squamous epithelial tissues. These are flat tissues. Now if you look at this diagram here, this is a simple squamous epithelial tissue. So what do we see here? That these tissues are flat, right? The cells are in fact flat. They are arranged edge to edge. If you look at this, edge to edge, there is no space in between the cells. So we will say no space, right? So they are arranged edge to edge. And in the surface view, what is the surface view? Surface view is this top view that we see. This tissue seems to be like a pavement, right? Pavement. At times we walk on the pavement layer on the road, right? So this appears to be a slightly raised kind of a platform, a pavement, right? So what do we see here is that the first thing is that the tissues are flat. The second character, no space, that means they are arranged edge to edge. And the third, the overview, seems to be like a pavement, right? Now these are the things we studied in the, you know, structure about the studied as the structure of the simple squamous epithelial tissues. Now because of this appearance like a pavement, this is also at times referred to as the pavement epithelium. Now where are these kind of tissues found? They are found in the peritoneal lining of the coelom, right? They are found in the pleural membrane, that is the membrane or the covering of the lungs. They are found in the pericardium. Pericardium is the membrane of the heart, right? Endothelium of blood vessels, lymph vessels, terminal bronchioles, alveoli of lung, Bowman's capsule, etc. We move on to the next type of cells. And that is the columnar cells. Now, this is the structure of the columnar cells, right? Now, what do we see over here? Again, we know that it is a simple columnar epithelium, means a single layer. And that you can see here that this is just a single layer of cells. But what is the difference is that these cells are slightly taller as compared to the squamous epithelium. Right, so these are elongated, right? If you look at these are elongated like this, right? Again they are placed side by side. Again what do we see is that there is no space between the cells, right? So they are placed side by side forming a column. So that is why they are known as columnar epithelium. Now it also says these columns have their long axis, this is the long axis, at right angles to the free surface. This is the free surface, right? The lower part is the attached surface. The upper part is the free surface. And so these columns are at right angle to the free surface, right? Now, these cells may be ciliated or non-ciliated. Now, what do we see here in this diagram is that this particular tissue is non-ciliated, right? But if we talk about a ciliated cell, then we will see that they are small hair-like structures that arise from the free surface of the cell. So then that becomes ciliated, right? Now the non-ciliated columnar epithelium, they are found in the mucosa of the alimentary canal, inner lining of the gallbladder and bile duct, whereas the ciliated ones are found in the uterine tube, that means the tube of the uterus in the females, right? In that, because it has to, the cells are ciliated, and with the hair-like structures, the egg cells are pushed, right? So in the uterine tube, in the oviduct also, because there also the egg has to, you know, move, so this helps in the movement. In the ureter, in the tympanic cavity, that is the ear, small bronchioles of the lungs, ventricles of the brain, etc. Right? So that's about the columnar epithelial. We move on to the third type of simple tissue, that is cuboidal epithelium. Right? So here is the cuboidal epithelial tissues. Again, simple, so only a single layer. And cuboidal, if you look at the structure, you will see that the cells are like a cube. So they are cuboidal, right? And it is adapted for secretion, absorption, excretion, and division. So this is a single layer thick tissue, and it is made up of cube shaped cells. Again, they are joined tightly. That means there is no space between the cells, right? It is found in the proximal and the distal convoluted tubules. You studied about the nephron, so that's the part of the nephron. They are found in the ciliary body, choroid, that is the eye, thin bronchioles, linings of sweat glands, etc. So that's about the simple epithelial tissues, right? And now we move on to the next part, that is the stratified epithelium. Now, what does the word stratified mean? Stratified means layered. One layer, two layer, three layer, four layer. So that is stratified. Now, these stratified tissues are also made up of either squamous, so many layers of squamous tissues, right? Or many layers of columnar tissues, or many layers of cuboidal tissues, right? So this makes up the stratified, various strata or layers, right? So it is not a single layer, it is made up of multiple layers, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, right? The oldest one is at the top, and the newest one starts from the base, right? So that is the stratified epithelial tissue, which is made up of several layers of cells, and on the basis of the topmost layer of cells, it is further classified, right? Topmost layer, what is the shape, right? So stratified squamous epithelium. Now we already know what is the squamous epithelial tissues like. The squamous epithelial tissues are, again, they are flat tissues, right? These are the squamous epithelial tissues, right? They are flat tissues and made up of several layers. So the first we see is keratinized, stratified squamous epithelium. Keratinized. Keratin is a protein that is present, and this kind of a stratified layer is present in the skin, right? So this is a protective layer which is made up of flat and dead cells. So keratinized cells, these are dead cells, and these cells are waterproof cells, right? So waterproof cells means it does not allow much water to escape from the part where it is present, right? So it covers the entire, you know, surface of the place where it is present, right? Then comes the non-keratinized, right? Non-keratinized means keratin not being present, and it is present in the lower part of the pharynx, linings of the buccal cavity, that is the mouth, esophagus, vagina, cornea of the eye, right? Coming to the next one is the stratified columnar epithelium, right? Stratified columnar means, again, when we talk about columnar, so the cells are like this. And stratified means many layered, right? Now, it is found in the male urethra, epiglottis, and some parts of larynx, pharynx, etc. Similarly, the stratified cuboidal is present in the conjunctiva of eye, linings of the duct of sweat glands, female urethra, part of the anal canal. We move to the third type, that is the pseudo-stratified epithelium, right? Pseudo-stratified. Now, coming, if you talk about the word pseudo, pseudo means false. Stratified means layers. So what do we understand is that false layer. Now, what happens is if we look at the structure of such tissues, these tissues appear to be somewhat like this. I'm just drawing, and you'll get an overview of what these tissues look like. Right now, if these are the cells of a tissue, right? So if we look at these cells, we find that there is one layer of cell here with the nucleus, and we find that there is another layer of cells at the bottom, and these are the nucleus. So it appears as if these are two layers of cells, but actually they are not two layers of cells. They are only a single layer. The only difference is that the size of the cell is different, right? Some cells are small, some cells are taller in height, right? So the ones which are smaller will obviously have the nucleus lower. The ones which are taller, their nucleus will be at the top, right? So that gives an appearance of a stratified layer. So this is not actually, they're not stratified, but they are false strata. False layers can be seen, right? They are actually single layered, but appears many layered due to uneven height of the cells, right? All the cells that make up this particular layer are unequal in height. And since they are unequal in height, it appears as if it is made up of many layers. So they are found in the linings of the pharynx, nasal cavity, trachea, bronchi, etc. Right? And we will stop here with these cells, and we will continue with the specialized epithelium. We will use the same PDF in the next class also, and we will talk about the specialized epithelium further up till the germinal epithelium, right? So for today and in the next class also, we will continue with the epithelial tissues. We have done the covering epithelium. In this, we've talked about the simple epithelium, that its types. We've talked about the stratified epithelium and its types. And we've talked about the pseudo-stratified epithelium, right? And we will continue the same epithelial tissues in the next class. And please complete your assignments. That's all for today. Thank you.